Compounds. We've focused most of our attention so far on relatively simple chemical species, species such as atoms and ions. In reality, many of the substances you come in contact with every day consist of collections of atoms or collections of ions that have been joined together. These are called compounds. So why do some elements form compounds while others remain in their elemental or ionic form? The answer has to do with stability. The more stable any chemical species is, the more likely it is to exist. We've already encountered this when discussing some of the stability aspects of the periodic table. For instance, the noble gases. We know that each one of the elements in the noble gases already has a complete valence shell, and therefore these elements are unlikely to react with any other elements on the table. They're chemically inert. We've also seen that some elements are able to gain or lose electrons. By gaining or losing electrons, these elements are able to complete their outer shell and become stable. So what about elements that aren't stable on their own or are not able to easily gain or lose electrons? These are elements that will need to form compounds to become stable. Let's start by looking at a special type of compound called an ionic compound. We already know that elements on the left side of the periodic table in groups 1, 2, 3, and the transition metals are likely to lose electrons and become cations. They're more stable in this form. Elements on the right side of the periodic table, especially those in group 6 and group 7, are likely to gain electrons to become more stable anions. But we haven't really talked about the entire picture. Let's look at a simple example that we're already familiar with. Let's look at sodium. We already know that the sodium atom is part of group 1, the alkali metals, and it's very reactive. The reason for that, as we've already discussed, is that it has exactly one valence electron. When alkali metals react, they lose that one valence electron, becoming positively charged. The sodium ion is very stable, and this is why the sodium in your body exists in the ionic form. But this doesn't explain the entire phenomenon. After all, if sodium loses an electron, where does it go? And for that matter, if we think about the elements on the right side of the periodic table, they gain electrons. Where do those electrons come from? Well, for this reason, some people prefer to think about the formation of ions not as gaining and losing electrons, but instead as an exchange of electrons. Let's look at sodium this way. Instead of sodium simply losing the electron, what if we put sodium near an element that's likely to gain electrons? Something like chlorine. Chlorine, in group 7 of the periodic table, has 7 valence electrons. When sodium and chlorine are in close contact with each other, the electron from sodium's outer shell can transfer to the outer shell of chlorine. In this process, the sodium becomes positively charged while the chlorine becomes negatively charged. In essence, this is the same phenomenon we've already discussed in ion formation. But now let's add some extra information. Once we have a positively charged sodium and a negatively charged chloride, we have two entities that will attract each other, because as we already know, opposites attract. When the sodium and chloride ions are near each other, they'll move close enough together to form what's called an ionic bond. An ionic bond is actually just an electrostatic attraction between two different charged species. In other words, an ionic bond is what happens when positive and negative attract. As a whole, we can refer to this as an ionic compound. An ionic compound is simply two or more ions that have been brought together through an ionic bond. This particular ionic compound is one that you're probably already familiar with, and it's named the way all ionic compounds are named, by saying the name of the cation followed by the name of the anion. In this case, our cation is the sodium ion, while our anion is the chloride ion. So we call this compound sodium chloride. Similarly, when we write the chemical formula for this and all ionic compounds, we always write the chemical symbol for the cation first. Sodium's chemical symbol is Na, while chloride's is Cl, so we write the chemical formula as NaCl. It's important to remember our rules about always capitalizing the first letter in a chemical symbol, and if there is a second letter, being sure that it's lowercase. You'll also notice that we do not include the positive or negative charge from an ion when writing the chemical formula. The reason for this is that positive and negative charges cancel each other out in ionic compounds. So when we write NaCl, we don't include positive or negative charges. When you think of sodium chloride, what comes to mind first is probably table salt, and that's because most of the weight of table salt is made up of sodium chloride. In reality, even the smallest crystal of table salt that you could see with the naked eye would actually have billions and billions of sodium ions, as well as billions and billions of chloride ions. It wouldn't be made up of just one sodium and just one chloride. This fact is true of all ionic compounds. We always choose a chemical formula that's as simple as possible, but in reality it represents a much larger chemical structure called a lattice. So the chemical formula actually represents the smallest repeating units of this lattice. Or you might think of it almost as a network. The network or the lattice of sodium chloride crystals simply consists of NaCl repeated over and over again. So if we could see at the molecular level for sodium chloride, we wouldn't just see one sodium and one chloride, but we would see NaCl repeated over and over. Sodium chloride is a great example of an ionic compound. For one reason, it's really common, and we're all comfortable thinking about salt crystals because we've encountered them in our everyday lives. In reality, sodium chloride is also a good example because it's a relatively simple ionic compound. You'll notice it only consists of one cation and one anion. In reality, not all ionic formulas contain exactly one cation and one anion. While all ionic compounds have cations and anions that attract each other, sometimes the ratio of the two is not 1:1. What drives the chemical formula for all ionic compounds is the need for the positive and negative charges to cancel out. So as we'll see now, the charges in any ionic compound must add up to zero. In something like sodium chloride, we have sodium with a +1 charge and chloride with a -1 charge. So simply putting one sodium and one chloride together allows the charges to cancel. But if we were to remove the sodium and replace it with a different cation, let's say magnesium for an example, we complicate things because magnesium, as our example, has a 2+ charge. We know this because it's located in group 2 on the periodic table. Now, if I bond magnesium with chloride, you can see that the charges don't cancel out. I have 2+ charges and only 1- charge. That doesn't mean there's no such thing as magnesium chloride. It simply means that the chemical formula for magnesium chloride is comprised of more than just 2 ions. Can you guess how it's different? Well, magnesium has 2+ charges, so to equal them out, we can't use 1 chloride ion, we need 2. So the chemical formula for magnesium chloride would have to reflect the fact that for every 1 positively charged magnesium, there are 2 negatively charged chlorides. Determining the chemical formulas for all ionic compounds is simply as easy as deciding which charges and how many numbers of ions you need to make those charges cancel out. Let's look at determining ionic formulas in detail. Every time you determine an ionic formula, you want to follow the same basic process, and we'll do several examples. In each one of these examples, the first thing we'll do is identify the charge on each ion that you're working with. You have to know whether they're +1, +2, -2, or any other number first. Then, decide how many of each ion you'll need to ensure that their charges will equal each other out, or in other words, that their charges will add up to zero. Finally, you're ready to write your chemical formula. Just remember, we always write the chemical formula for ionic compounds with the cation first. Let's try a couple examples. First, let's write the chemical formula for calcium fluoride. If you'd like, you can pause the video. The first step in determining the chemical formula for calcium fluoride is to determine the charges on each of these ions. Calcium, located in group 2 of the periodic table, has a 2 positive charge. Fluoride is derived from the fluorine atom. Remember, all anions have the ending "-ide," even though their original element usually has a different ending. So the fluorine atom in group 7 creates the fluoride ion. The fluoride ion, like all ions from group 7 elements, has a 1 negative charge. I can't put one calcium and one fluoride together because they won't equal each other out. So I have to decide how many of each ion are needed. In other words, do I need more calcium ions to make this compound work, or do I need more fluoride ions? As you might be able to tell, I need twice as many fluoride ions as I do of calcium. So if I realize that I need, for every one calcium, 2 fluoride ions, I'm prepared to write the chemical formula. Remember, we always write the cation first in our chemical formula. So the chemical formula for calcium fluoride is CaF2. The Ca has no number after it because that implies we only need one Ca, or one calcium, and the fluoride, because we need 2 of them, has the number 2 written as a subscript. The chemical formula for calcium fluoride is CaF2. Let's try another example. Take a moment, pause the video, and see if you can write the ionic formula, or the chemical formula, for the ionic compound potassium sulfide. The first step in writing the chemical formula for potassium sulfide is to determine the charge on each of these ions. Potassium, located in group 1 of the periodic table, has a 1 positive charge, so I write K+. Sulfide is derived from sulfur. Sulfur, the element, is in group 6 of the periodic table, so as it forms the sulfide ion, it develops a 2 negative charge. I can't combine one potassium and one sulfide and have them cancel out, so I have to recognize that I need twice as much potassium for each sulfide ion. By combining 2 potassiums with every one sulfide, I arrive at the chemical formula K2S. 2 potassiums for each sulfide. K2S is the chemical formula for potassium sulfide. Let's do one more example. Take a moment and write the chemical formula for aluminum oxide. Aluminum oxide is comprised of 2 ions. The first, aluminum, is located in group 3 of the periodic table, so we know it has a 3 positive charge. Oxide is the ion derived from the oxygen element on group 6 of the periodic table. Like all elements in group 6, oxide has a 2 minus charge as an ion. Aluminum oxide has a chemical formula that's slightly more difficult to determine because we can't simply double the number of one of these ions. You may have to use something like common denominators to determine this. In the end, if you notice that we need more aluminum and also more oxide, you're on the right track. In reality, to make these work out, we need 2 aluminum ions for every 3 oxygen ions. Notice that a little bit of a crisscross has happened here. Some people like to use the shortcut, especially in cases like this, of remembering that whatever the charge is on an ion, there's a good chance that you'll need the absolute value of that charge for the opposing ion. In other words, the charge on aluminum was 3+, so not surprisingly, I needed 3 oxygens to make this formula work, while the charge on oxygen was a 2-, so I needed 2 aluminums to make the formula work. In the end, no matter how you figure it out, the chemical formula for aluminum oxide is Al2O3. While we will always follow the same basic steps to determine the chemical formulas of ionic compounds, sometimes you might have a little bit more information to consider. For instance, when we write the chemical formulas for compounds that involve transition metals. The transition metals, located in the middle of the periodic table, are always cations when they exist in their ionic form. However, many of the transition metals can form multiple charges. In other words, they might exist as a plus one in one compound and a plus two in another compound. For this reason, remember that you can always refer to the name of the transition metal or the name of the ionic compound to determine the charge on that transition metal. For example, the ionic compound iron-3-fluoride. We know iron is a transition metal because we can locate it on the periodic table, but we don't know what its charge is without the additional information that we're talking about iron-3. Once we know that information, we follow the exact same steps we discussed in our last slide in order to make the chemical formula. Iron, Fe, we now know has a 3 plus charge. That's what the Roman numeral 3 tells us. Fluoride, coming from group 7 on the periodic table, fluorine, we already know has a negative 1 charge. So to determine the chemical formula for iron-3-fluoride, the 3 only refers to the charge on the ion. The rest is up to you. Based on this information, go ahead and write the chemical formula for iron-3-fluoride. Just like we discussed previously, we have to make the charges cancel out. Since I have a 3 plus charge on the iron and a 1 minus charge on the fluoride, for every 1 iron, I'll need 3 fluoride ions. The end result when I write my chemical formula is to write FeF3. Notice that the Roman numeral 3 does not appear in the chemical formula. The reason for this is that anybody who's aware of the rules of ionic compounds will know that the iron must have a 3 plus charge if it's been bonded with 3 fluoride ions. For this reason, there's a lot of different ways that you can determine charge on transition metals, except you can't do it just by looking at the periodic table. So when it comes to transition metals, just remember to check for the charge as written as a Roman numeral in the name of the compound. Another time where you might have a little more to consider about ionic compounds and ionic formulas is when working with polyatomic ions. Generally, nothing will be done any differently if you write the chemical formula for most polyatomic ions in an ionic compound. However, if you need more than one of a polyatomic ion, we always use parentheses simply for clarity. Let me show you two examples so you can see why. First, let's write the chemical formula for the ionic compound sodium bicarbonate. Bicarbonate, as we learned previously, is a polyatomic ion. You can refer to your polyatomic ion chart from your textbook or online in order to determine both its charge and its chemical formula. Bicarbonate has the chemical formula HCO3 with a 1 minus charge. Sodium, as we already know, in group 1 has a 1 plus charge. Now that I'm comfortable with what the two different ions are, I can write the chemical formula relatively easy. And because I have one positive charge and one negative charge, I simply need one sodium for each bicarbonate. The end result is that my chemical formula will be Na, because I always write the positively charged cation first, HCO3 to represent my anion, bicarbonate. I haven't done anything different because the polyatomic ion is there. I simply write it in the second spot. That changes a little bit if I need more than one of the polyatomic ion. Let's do calcium bicarbonate as an example. Take a second and see if you can write the chemical formula for calcium bicarbonate based on what we just did. Calcium, from group 2, has a 2 positive charge, and we already know that bicarbonate has the chemical formula HCO3 with a 1 minus charge. You can see, by inspection, that you can't simply put one calcium and one bicarbonate together. Instead, for every one calcium, I'll need 2 bicarbonates. So how do I write this in a chemical formula? Well, If we didn't follow the rule about parentheses, we'd start by writing the cation first, Ca, and then I'd write the fact that there's bicarbonate, HCO3, and then I'd add the subscript 2 to mean I need two of them. You can tell, that doesn't look right. Now it's not clear whether I need 32 oxygen atoms or whether the 2 is applied to something else. There's a lot of confusion. So this is not very helpful. When you need more than one of a polyatomic, this is the correct time to use parentheses. So the true and correct way to write the chemical formula for calcium bicarbonate is to write Ca and then to put the bicarbonate in parentheses. It's a lot like the way we use parentheses in math. Once I have the parentheses, I can use the same old subscript, 2 in this case, and it applies to everything within the parentheses. So parentheses are only used when you need more than one of the same polyatomic ion, such as with calcium bicarbonate. If you only need one of a polyatomic ion, just write the entire thing in the same spot, just like it was a more simple ion. There are many different ionic compounds out there, and some you've probably already heard of. One of the ones that we seem to refer to a lot is table salt, or NaCl. It's worth pointing out that the table salt you use at home isn't pure sodium chloride. It probably has added iodide if it's manufactured salt. If it's evaporated sea salt, you can count on the fact that it contains many other ions. However, all types of food and seasoning salts are usually predominantly sodium and chloride ions. While salt is a general term that most people use to describe sodium chloride, salt to a scientist can actually refer to any ionic compound. So while when you're having a dinner table conversation and someone asks you to pass the salt, they probably mean table salt. In a lab, if someone asks you to pass the salt, there could literally be hundreds of different compounds they're referring to. Another type of salt that you might actually have already heard of is Epsom salt. Epsom salts are prescribed by healthcare professionals for a lot of different purposes, including salt baths. Epsom salt is magnesium sulfate. It has the chemical formula MgSO4. Notice that the anion in Epsom salt is sulfate, a polyatomic ion. The A-T-E ending indicates that it is actually sulfur bonded to oxygen. Another ionic compound that you probably have at home right now is baking soda. Baking soda, as we saw on the previous slide, is simply sodium bicarbonate, or NaHCO3. Notice some of the physical similarities between these three different substances. One of the first things you'll notice is they're all solid. And in fact, not only are most ionic compounds solid at room temperature, they're usually solid crystals, and very frequently they are white. There are examples of colored ionic compounds, but again, they all tend to be solid and frequently crystal at room temperature. Many of these ionic compounds dissolve when combined with water. We use the term soluble to describe how much or to what extent a compound dissolves in water. Many ionic compounds are very soluble, meaning you can dissolve a lot of them into water, such as when you dissolve table salt into a pot of boiling water. Another thing that's interesting about ionic compounds is that when they do dissolve in water, they're able to conduct electricity even better than the pure water itself. For this reason, many ionic compounds and ions themselves are referred to as electrolytes. These salts that are dissolved in your bloodstream allow your body to pass electrical signals when necessary. The salt that's in the water around you makes it able to conduct electricity, which is one of the reasons that it's not good to go swimming during a lightning storm. Let's talk a little bit more about this idea of ionic compounds dissolving in water and conducting electricity. Many different ionic compounds are soluble or dissolvable in water. If we go back to using our favorite example of table salt, you've probably seen white salt crystals dissolve into something like a glass of water or maybe a pot of pasta water. We know that when salt crystals dissolve, it's almost as if they disappear. They become invisible to the naked eye. So when you take salt and you drop it into water, maybe you have to stir the water a little bit, but eventually it's almost as if the salt disappears. If you taste that water, you can taste the salt, so we know that it's still there. What's happening on a molecular level is that these individual salt crystals, made up of billions and billions of sodium and chloride ions, are actually breaking apart as they dissolve. When dissolving, all ionic compounds break apart. This is a process called dissociation. So we say that ionic compounds dissociate when they dissolve. Thinking about sodium chloride, we know that the crystal lattice structure of sodium chloride has many alternating sodium and chloride ions. When we drop that crystal lattice structure into water, those ions separate or dissociate and move in separate directions. It's almost as if they go their own separate ways. So while we start out with a lattice of sodium and chloride, once dissolved in water, we actually have separate sodium ions and chloride ions floating freely in that solution. Let's look at how we can show this in a symbolic form. One way to do this is by using something called a chemical equation. Chemical equations, like mathematical equations, are simply a way of using symbols to demonstrate a process that happens. In this particular process of salt dissolving, I'll start by writing the chemical formula for the salt, NaCl. I'm using an S as a subscript in parentheses here to indicate the physical state of that particular compound. The sodium chloride we start with is a solid, so I write S for solid. We know that sodium chloride is made up of sodium ions and chloride ions. When dissolved in water, these sodium ions and chloride ions begin to dissociate or separate from each other. As that happens, I end up first with sodium ions. The sodium ion is Na+, so I write that, indicating that I have sodium ions. I don't want to write an S for solid next to the sodium, because as you know, if you've ever dissolved salt in water, there's usually no solid remaining. Instead, I'm going to write the chemical symbol AQ. AQ stands for the word aqueous. Aqueous simply means dissolved in water. So Na+, with an AQ in parentheses, means Na+ dissolved in water. The other ion involved in sodium chloride is the chloride ion, and I can show that also in my chemical equation. I write Cl- with an AQ showing that it's aqueous. Remember, when sodium chloride dissociates in water, or when it dissolves, it actually breaks apart into these separate sodium and chloride ions. You can picture that using ions and atoms in your head, or you can write it using a chemical equation. Let's look at a few other examples. Calcium chloride is another example of an ionic compound that dissolves in water. If we think about what calcium chloride is actually made of, we can notice that there's two different types of ions. The first is calcium. Calcium from group 2 has a 2 positive charge. What's the other ion that's involved in calcium chloride? Well, you may have said chloride, which is correct. But notice there are 2 chloride ions. We know this because Cl, the chloride ion, has a 2 as a subscript after it. If I dissolve calcium chloride in water, just like with the sodium chloride, the ions dissociate from each other. Each ion goes its own separate way. I can also show this using a chemical equation, just as we did in the previous example. The first ion that I read about is calcium. Calcium has a 2+ charge. To write that in my chemical equation, I simply write calcium 2+. Again, dissolving it in water, I'll write AQ to symbolize that it's aqueous. The other ion that's present is chloride. It's important to realize that the chloride ion, Cl, has a negative charge, and when dissolved in water, it'll be aqueous. So I'll write AQ. How many chloride ions were in this compound? Well, we know that it takes 2 chloride ions to equal out that positive charge on the calcium. So, to write this correctly in my chemical equation, I'll show that I have 2 chloride ions. One place where a lot of people get tripped up when they first start doing this is why the subscript changes to what's called a coefficient, or a number in front of a different chemical species. The reason is we want to show each individual ion that's present. Writing Cl2 implies that I have chlorides connected to each other, or part of a larger molecule. So I don't want to write Cl2 in my chemical equation. If I do that, it's showing that the chloride ions did not dissociate, that they actually are somehow stuck together. And that's not true when it comes to what happens with dissolving ionic compounds. So calcium chloride, in its solid form, when you put it in water, dissociates to make one calcium 2 plus ion and two chloride 1 minus ions. Let me show you one more example. We talked previously about Epsom salts, which are comprised of magnesium ions and sulfate ions, or MgSO4. This is an example of an ionic compound that has a polyatomic ion. Remember that polyatomic ions are not treated any differently than regular single atom ions. So, when I think about magnesium sulfate dissolving in water, I don't want to complicate things by becoming confused by the sulfur and the oxygen. Instead, I just want to think about Epsom salts, or magnesium sulfate, as being comprised of two different ions. Those two ions, magnesium and sulfate, go in separate directions. To show that in a chemical equation, I would write the chemical formula or the chemical symbol for magnesium, Mg2+, and of course it's aqueous once it's dissolved in water, and I'd write the chemical formula or the chemical symbol for my second ion, in this case, sulfate, SO4 2-, and again, it would be aqueous. I don't separate the individual atoms in this case because they're part of a polyatomic ion. So if we compare our previous example with Cl2 and this example with SO4, the difference in whether you do or do not write those ions separately has to do with whether they are separate ions that were used to make a chemical formula or whether they're simply separate atoms that were used to construct one polyatomic ion. So why do some ionic compounds like calcium chloride, sodium chloride, and magnesium sulfate dissolve in water? The answer to this question is just the same answer we give a lot of times when asking why things happen in chemistry. The answer is stability. The more stable those ions are in their dissociated form, the more likely that ionic compound is to dissolve in water. Why would an ion be more stable after it dissolved? Well, this is something we'll talk about later in the course, but it has to do with how those separated or dissociated ions are surrounded by the water molecules they dissolve into. The better the job the water can do of surrounding the ions, the more stable they'll be. Even though this is true for a lot of ionic compounds, water is not equally good at dissolving all ionic compounds. So some ionic compounds are soluble in water, while others are not. Furthermore, there's a lot of shades of gray here. Some ionic compounds dissolve to large extents, while other ones don't dissolve quite as much. We call that sparingly soluble. Some ionic compounds will dissolve in neutral water, while other ones have to dissolve in water of a certain pH. There's a lot of different rules when it comes to solubility, and you'll start to recognize some compounds that dissolve reliably. But in the end, you can always fall back on a solubility chart to tell you whether an ionic compound will or won't dissolve in water. Most solubility charts, including the one I'll show you, work on the basis of telling you for any given ionic compound whether it's soluble or insoluble in relatively room temperature, neutral pH water. The chart that we'll be using is the one you can see on your screen now, and this is also available on our website. I'll give this to you on exams, and you can also bring it to class to refer to. On the left-hand side of the chart, you'll see a list of cations. You can correspond those cations with any anion that they may be bonded with, which are shown across the top of the chart. You'll notice that the key for this chart uses a series of dark circles and light circles, as well as a V, to signify whether the compound is soluble in water or insoluble. Remember, a compound that's soluble in water will dissolve when mixed with water, while a compound that's insoluble will be a solid even when you mix it with water. To use this chart, you simply correspond each cation with whatever anion it's bonded with. For instance, let's say that we had the compound ammonium iodide. By locating the ammonium ion on the left side
and the iodide ion across the top, we can simply use the chart to determine that these two compounds would be, well, they have a black dot, which means they'd be soluble. In other words, ammonium iodide would dissolve in water and separate into an ammonium ion and an iodide ion. In turn, if we have a compound like aluminum hydroxide, aluminum and hydroxide, when put together, would be insoluble in water, so they wouldn't dissolve, meaning it would remain a solid even when mixed with water. You can refer to this chart for a wide variety of ionic compounds, which is one reason we really like using it. Again, you'll find the solubility chart on our website. And this concludes our lecture on ionic compounds.